Good morning, everybody. I am very happy to be in this program because, as Satya in his towards the end said, the students from Telugu speaking states, Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, is very less in higher studies. Possibly everybody goes to engineering and wants to settle in the US. Okay, well, I understand that. But I think there are still a lot more talent in every field of knowledge from Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. So I wish that our program will help you people to come to do some serious science also. Right. So my topic is going to be real analysis. It's pretty vague as of now. But whatever I'm going to do, the best reference is the book by me and my co-author Ajit Kumar, A Basic Course in Real Analysis. It's available in Indian reprint. In case you don't get it, you can send me an email which is given above. And again, as Satya said, I have released about, in the last 3 weeks, I have released about 28 videos on various aspects of real analysis, starting with upper bounds, lower bounds, least upper bound, greatest lower bound, or the fancy name like supremum, infimum, Archimedean property, and then sequences, and the last is continuity. Okay. And all these things you can see in youtube.com in the channel Kumar HCU. Instead of Kumaresan, I wrote Kumar, and HCU was Hyderabad Central University. So it's an easy mnemonic for you to remember. And there are certain things which I think Satya seemed to have already told you. He seemed to have followed what I insist on in MTTS classrooms and in online classrooms also. Okay, the session will be highly interactive as his session. And whenever we ask questions, I do not want anybody to come online, unmute their mic and orally answer. No. Okay, you can use the hand raise sign either to ask doubts. Also, when I ask you a question, you can say, yes, I had understood. You see that when I ask you a question, I don't think yes is available on this WebEx platform, but you can raise hand. And please do not answer orally. Keep your mic muted all the time. Okay, and you can use hand raise sign. If you understood the question, you have some kind of an idea for an answer. That's good enough for me. Okay. Then, as Satya said, I may call out a participant, he or she may answer the question. Okay. Now, let's do few things. See, whenever teachers and students think of real analysis, they are always obsessed with continuity. Right? They think real analysis starts with continuity. It's unfortunately, that's a main problem why many people do not understand real analysis. Okay. This is like saying, without any proper foundation, I want to live in the fourth floor apartment. Okay. So naturally, it will not be safe. The same thing happens. So I would suggest what one should do, one should start with the real number system basic. Do not worry about construction as Rudin or other books do that. Don't worry. And do not worry about algebra. Okay. Uniqueness, additive inverse, uniqueness, additive identity, and commutativity, generalized idea, associative law, all this kind of algebra, leave it algebraized. You should start with what the notion of order relations, bounds, upper bounds, lower bounds, least upper bound, greatest lower bound, and if you want a fancy name, right? Already English is a foreign language to us. You want to use Latin, supremum, infimum, I don't understand what they mean. And Archimedean property, density of rations. This is the basic about real number system. One has to understand this. If you don't understand, believe me, you'll have problem with analysis. Okay, no amount of continuity lectures is going to help you. And the next thing is, analysis is something very interesting. You want to prove, solve an equation. That means you want to prove something equal to something. Okay, suppose I want to say A equal to B. In analysis, you never do that. Very rarely you will be able to show A equal to B. The only way you show is either A is less than or equal to B and B is less than or equal to A. Or even that is acceptable. But most often that also you can't do that. What you try to show is mod A minus B is less than every positive epsilon. And hence mod A minus B is 0 and A equal to B. So that means estimates and inequalities are integral part of analysis. Okay, unless you understand this, it will be very, very difficult. Do you follow me? In analysis, the most important thing is you have to learn to use inequalities and what I call estimates. That's why I said upper bound, lower bound should be understood properly. And the best platform and the easiest platform to master this, learn and master this is sequences chapter. Okay. And in almost all analysis course in India and even abroad, what I find is sequences start in higher secondary school and various tests. This is convergent, this is not convergent, this is divergent to infinity. This kind of circus is what you do. You don't learn the rigorous mathematics there. Like a calculus you are doing. And with the result, when it comes to analysis, teachers look down upon the chapter. On sequences. And believe me, sequences is the first place which is much easier. You can learn all the tricks of analysis. Next comes to continuity. Now you can see that. Without this, all of you want to learn continuity. Yesterday, I was present towards the end. All of you asked a question. Sir, continuity epsilon delta, students find it very difficult. Yeah. And Kannan went to completely tangential direction. He said, yeah, it's difficult. Koshi is to be blamed. But there is a much another way, infinitesimal number system, okay. But then to build that system takes a lot of time. So we have to live with epsilon delta. This is very unfortunate. Last 30 years, I have been trying to say there is an easier approach to continuity. Epsilon delta come later. The easier approach is based on the principle of mathematics. A participant, I have a question. Okay, please, if you want to do it by chat also. Now, I am going to give an option. Do you want to learn about bounds, upper bounds, least upper bounds? Or do you want to learn about the easy way of defining continuity and proving theorems? Or do you want the epsilon, you want me to explain how epsilon delta can be motivated and explained very well? These are three options. Okay, first option is bounds, second option is easy definition of continuity, third option is epsilon delta. Please send me your choice 1, 2, 3. That's it. Okay, good. So I think the majority seems to be 3. So let me stick to that. Enough, thank you. You can please don't send any more chats. So am I going to ask you a question? If I give you something like a million rupees, can anybody get me 1 gram of 100% pure gold? I'm doing mathematics. Okay? I'm on a jewelry shop. Is the question clear? I am ready to give you million rupees, is there anybody who can guarantee that he can give me 100% pure gold 1 gram? Okay, even the best lab cannot say that. they cannot do that. Now that where analysis starts. Very good, that's enough. Thank you, no more chat. Very good. That's where the analysis starts. So let me try to say this. I will draw a picture, although it's in a two-dimensional matrix space, okay? But think of real line also if you want, okay? So I have a scientific process called ETF. It is a scientific procedure, well laid down thing, okay? F is. F is a scientific process. Okay, what does it do? It takes an input and produces an output. Okay, now a customer wants a why not, like 1 gram pure gold, 100% pure gold. Okay, or some process. So what the scientific process says is, if you give me X naught, then the process F will produce from X naught to Y naught. The process would have produced this output. Do you understand this? The scientifically proved process. If you give me two hydrogen atoms, one oxygen atom, then I can produce one molecule, water molecule. Purest. You understand this? So this is a scientific process. But just now all of you said, it's not at all possible to get Y naught purest to Y naught. So what do you do? How many of you bought Akshay Tritiya? What is it? Akshay Tritiya. Gold coins. Yeah? You must have, if you find a gold coin, they will say it is 99.99% pure. Right? It's not 100% pure. You understand? That means you are ready to give money for 1 gram gold, not for pure gold, if it is 99, at least 99.99% pure. That means you set an error limit. E is the error. E, epsilon stands for E, and E stands for error. You understand this? So what you are saying is, I want Y naught. I know F will produce Y naught if X naught is pure. But you know, it's impossible to find X naught, pure X naught, even though scientific process here will produce correctly. If X naught is pure, I'll get a pure Y naught. I do not. I know I may not get. What I am doing is, I am getting an error. And how much of error I can tolerate. So you give me a Y, which is approximately equal to Y naught. And what is the difference between them? The error may be at most epsilon. That is, here the error is not 100% pure, it is 0.001%. Error margin you are allowing. You tell me this this much of error I am able to tolerate. Even though I would like to have Y naught, I am ready to accept Y if Y is epsilon close to Y naught. Then what do I know? The scientist here, the lab, he knows he cannot produce X naught pure X naught, but he knows if my X is delta close, okay, delta close to X naught, then F of X, whatever F of X, will be epsilon close to Y naught. Take 20 seconds, think about. If you want me to repeat, say yes. Can I go ahead? Nobody said they want me to repeat. So that means everybody understood. So let me repeat. F is a scientific process. If you give me X naught, it will certainly produce Y naught. But I know producing X naught may be difficult. The pure X naught I may not be able to get. So the consumer tells me, he gives me an error estimate epsilon. Whatever Y you give me, if it is within epsilon distance from Y naught, I will accept it. Then the fellow at the lab, the scientist knows, okay, I may not be able to get a pure X, but if I can find it, sorry, pure X naught, if I can find an X which is delta close to X naught, then if I apply the scientific process F to X, it will produce Fx, but that Fx will be epsilon close to Y naught. Okay, now you can see continuity was dictated by real life applications. It's not mathematician's dream, pure kind of abstract nonsense. It is demanded by scientists. It is demanded by, if you want, national security, right? Everybody talks about national security. Let us talk about national security. Okay. So there is another country. This is another country. And I know there is a terrorist camp here. Okay. Now my military knows, okay, I have intercontinental missile, ballistic missile. If I launch it at a particular angle and with a particular initial velocity, okay, it can hit, this rocket will hit Y naught and destroy. But you could never be sure of that. Why? The angle is again approximation, and that particular wind may be slightly different. All those things will affect instant. Okay, if you launch this rocket, it may not hit Y naught. But what I know is, it will, wherever it hits, it destroys something about 1 kilometer radius. Destroys everything. In particular, so it does not have to hit Y naught. Even if it is here, this fellow will be destroyed. So what all I have to do is, I have to say initial velocity instead of 2000 kilometers. Okay, even if it is 1990 to 2012, and if the wind speed is the northeastern direction, about 12 kilometers, okay, 8 to 12 kilometers per speed, then it's all right, because I cannot be sure. If it is exactly 10, if it is exactly 2000 kilometers, it will hit Y naught, but I cannot be sure. Do you understand? Please say yes if you understand. Okay, right, enough, thank you. Next question. Now suppose you give this kind of example before you even talk about continuity, epsilon delta definition, don't they think the students will be more attentive? They will be eager to learn? You don't want, because it just takes 20 seconds for me to write down the definition, epsilon delta definition. Okay. So let us look at, so I'm going to make a formal definition. I will stick to real line. Whatever I do can also be done in metric spaces, but all of you would like to teach real line first, I hope. Do you want metric space or do you want real line? It's the same thing anyway. So let A be any non-empty subset of R. Okay. Remember, usually for continuity analysis courses will take A2 by an interval. Finite, infinite, bounded, unbounded, closed, semi-closed, nothing. It could be any set. If, for example, A could be a singleton. Or A could be a finite set. Or A could be set of all integers. Or A could be any interval of any kind. You understood that? Okay. Now I have a function here from A to R, and I fix a point A in A. I want to define F is continuous at A. So what does it mean? Let's go back to the earlier thing. This is my real line. I look at f of a, right? So if you give me a, I would have produced f a, but I know it may not be possible. So you give me an error tolerance. How much error you can tolerate? That is your epsilon. So if you give me epsilon positive, for any epsilon positive, I form this interval. So what do I want? I want fx to lie here if x is close to a. That's what we said earlier, right? There exists a delta positive such that for all x in a intersection a minus delta to a plus delta, okay, fx should lie in this interval. If you want in terms of modulus, for all x in A, such that mod x minus A less than delta should imply mod fx minus fa should be less than epsilon. How many of you understand the definition? Very good. Now let's look at, okay, enough, thank you, enough, stop. Now let's look at this. What is the crucial thing I should look at the definition? See, most often I have seen even some teachers saying definition should be memorized. Okay. That's one of the silliest things to say. Definitions are the building blocks of mathematics. So definitions should be understood. The way to understand the definition is to kind of dissect it, put it in pieces, try to understand each and every part, then again assemble together. I am going to do that now. Okay. So what is given to me? If I want to say f is continuous at a, you are going to think of the given epsilon. How do I think of epsilon? I am thinking of epsilon as an error. How much error I can tolerate? I want fa, but I am ready to tolerate error up to epsilon distance. That means I form this interval. Then what do I do? Now let's look at, I don't know set A, it may not be, but A is in the set A. Then I form the interval A minus delta to A plus delta, right? In your usual courses, you will say for every x here. But I can't do that. Why? For example, this x okay, it may be here, but it may not be an element of A, therefore fx may not even make sense because the domain of f is A. Therefore, I want to make sure x belong to A as well as mod x minus A is less than delta. So you are taking this interval, intersecting those points. Then look at only those x which are in this interval as well as in A. That's what this means. Then what do I want? Then f of x makes sense. Then I want f of x to lie in this interval. In terms of modulus, it is written as mod fx minus fa. Do you understand this? Okay. Can I go ahead? Please say yes if I can go ahead. Okay. So this is what continuity means. Let's try to look at this once again. So what are the things? The first thing you are given is you are giving an epsilon. Then I form this interval. Next, what do? I have to find a delta. Then I form this interval. Do I take all elements x? No. I take only those elements which are in the intersection. X in A intersection, A minus delta to A plus delta. This kind of x are not allowed. This is not element of right? Then what do I want? For that x, fx should lie here. Okay, very good. Now let's look at some simple examples. The first thing is, when you want to check continuity, this is another problem. There is always a mystery. You look at all books, let epsilon be given. Yes, a function is given. Consider f from here to here. Then let f, I want to check it's continuous at a point A, then epsilon be given. Then immediately that the book author or the teacher will say, choose delta equal to this. See, that is where the students really are completely thrown off guard. They don't understand. It looks like a magician. You take your rabbit out of a hat. Okay? Naturally, they don't understand. Is there any logic? How did the teacher knew? This is the delta he has to choose. Okay? Now, the rest of my lecture, I am going to dispel that myth. Okay? What do I mean? I am going to show how to choose delta. Okay? It is, so what I call this method, I call as working backwards or discovery method. If you notice, Satya employed it in the last lecture. He didn't use that word he wanted to say, but somehow he refrained from using that word at some point. Okay, this is in contrast with the standard thing which you always see, a direct verification method. What is verification? Delta is given, you make sure that delta works. Okay, but you don't know how the delta was found out, whereas we are going to discover that. Do you appreciate what I'm saying? The next thing is, in this definition, you should see something very interesting. If suppose there is a delta positive, you gave me an epsilon, there is a delta positive such that this happens. Now suppose I have a delta 1 which is less than delta, do you think for delta 1 also this will be true? Yes, for every x in A, that is mod x minus A is less than delta 1, it will also be less than delta. Right? You understand that? Therefore, if x lies in the interval A, intersection A minus delta 1 to A plus delta 1, then fx will also lie there. So this delta is not unique. That's the first observation you should make. Because again, you will see, take minimum of this or that in the textbook. Why I have to take? This is the reason. Okay? If one delta works, any positive delta less than that will also work for the same epsilon. Is that clear to all? Okay. Next, when I want to check, if you give me a function here from A to R and you fix an A in A, you want to check continuity at A. Okay? So, I will not worry about epsilon. I will not worry about delta. Right? I'll just ignore. What will I do? I will do what I want to do here. Later I will say, if you give me an epsilon, I will say keep it aside. I will make use of it later. So if I want to check continuity of F at A, what I have to estimate, you see that I am using the word which I introduced in the beginning. Analysis means estimate inequality. I want to estimate fx minus fa. If x is very near to a, I want to estimate fx minus fa. I will not worry about epsilon. My way of doing will choose delta also. Let us go slow. We will work out examples. Do not despair. Okay? Right. And to do this kind of estimate, there is one trick in analysis which I always use, not I use, any analyst will use. Suppose you have two real numbers, let us say, I hope you don't mind if I write x and y, okay? X and y are real numbers. And suppose you want me to prove x is less than y, okay, I may not be able to directly show x is less than y. What I may show is x is less than or equal to some z. And again, that is, I will simplify this expression for x and get something. It is less than or equal to z. Then even this z, I may not be able to show less than y. I may show this is less than or equal to some t. Then t may be simple enough to show t is less than y. Right? Therefore, I will conclude x is less than y. That is why you see in analysis textbook, lot of inequalities. What was my aim? My aim was to show x is less than y. But how do I achieve it? Do I directly show? No, I may not be able to show. I will try to estimate x, it is less than or equal to z. And that also may not be good enough for me. I will again simplify or do some manipulations, show z is less than or equal to t. Then it may be easier for me to show t is less than y. Then it automatically follows x is less than y. You understand this trick? This is the single most important trick in analysis. That is why you will see, you open any analysis book, good analysis book, okay? Few topological notions, metric space books will not show this much of thing. Pure analysis book will show a lot of inequalities to prove a theorem. This is the reason. Do you understand this? I cannot rectify audio. It usually means your network is problematic, because many people have no problem with audio. Okay. So I'm sorry. Okay. You have to check your network. Right. Do you understand this? This is what. So these are the two tricks I am going to employ now. What are the two tricks I am going to employ? To check f is continuous at a, I will worry about how to estimate mod fx minus a. Next, this mod fx minus fa, I want to choose, show that it's less than epsilon whenever mod x minus a is less than delta. That is at the back of my mind. Okay, that means I have to estimate this value. This should be less than epsilon. That is x is less than y kind of thing. That means I will show this is less than or equal to something, and that is less than or equal to something, that is less than epsilon, if then that will give me delta. Okay, do not worry if it looks abstract. Look at this is a kind of plan of attack. I have a strategy how to work with the problem. I am giving the strategy. Now you will see in every example the same strategy is going to work. Okay, now let's look at. As usual, I can work with, you know, constant function, identity function, etc. Okay, it will be quite boring. It will not give you what I want really. So let us look at some function f. Okay, f constant, easy. F identity. These are the first thing you always your teachers do. As teachers, you also do. Okay, I don't want to do that. F is a function from R to R. Let us look at the function f of x. Equal to x squared and fix a real number a in R. I want to check continuity at a. Okay, this is what I want to check. Right, now go back. What did I say to check continuity at a? You are going to give me an epsilon. What I am going to say? Keep aside your epsilon, I will use it later. So I will say I want to estimate only mod fx minus fa. Right? So let me look at what is mod fx minus fa. What is x? X must be in the domain of the function. I don't care whether it's near or far away. That also I don't worry about. Now let us look at what is fx minus fa. It is x squared minus a squared. Now all of us have done algebra from 7th or 8th standard. The moment I say a squared minus b squared, I know what to do. You also know what to do, right? Yes or no? All of you know what to do? So I will do the same thing. I will write it is x minus a into x plus a. You see that I am simplifying the expression. Now equality. Next, this is mod of xy is same as mod x into mod y, therefore this is equal to mod x minus y into mod x plus y. So far there is no inequality, everything is hunky-dory. You understand? Now comes the problem. I want to say this is less than epsilon if mod x minus a is less than delta. You see that? Luckily I found the term mod x minus a here. So if this is less than delta, I want this product should be less than epsilon. You understand? For what x? I don't have any idea what x. For all x in the domain, but for all x near a. Therefore, what do I do? Let's go back to what I said. If I said, if to find a delta, I can assume any delta less than delta 1 also will work. So therefore, I can restrict. Okay. This is my a. Okay. I will restrict my x only to the interval a minus 1 to a plus 1. That is that. Okay. Mod x minus a is less than 1. Only for those x I look at that. What was the reason? I want to show this is less than or equal to c times mod x minus a. Suppose I show that, what do I know? I want this to be less than epsilon, mod fx minus f to be less than epsilon. But that is less than or equal to c times mod x minus a. If I show this is less than epsilon, then mod fx minus f will be less than epsilon. To show this is less than epsilon, I want to make sure mod x minus a should be less than epsilon by c. That means I have to choose a delta to be epsilon by c or anything less than 0 less than. Do you understand the strategy? So I have to find an estimate for mod x plus a. Is that clear? Now, did I take any x? Because, for example, look at the domain. Domain is all of R. Suppose my A is 0. You can take X to be any natural number. So it will be very, very huge. You understand that? This will be N plus 0. That will be very large. Okay. So I want to restrict. How do I restrict? I allow only those X which are very near to A, which is distance of 1. Now if mod X minus A is less than delta. Next, I want a triangle inequality. Let us look at that. So I am traveling directly from here to here now. Okay, equal to mod x minus a. Now I want an inequality. For mod x plus a, what is the obvious inequality I have? The important inequality for analysis is, can somebody tell me? Now you can use our chat. Tell me what inequality I should use for mod x plus a. Use chat to tell me. Yes.
Mod a plus b is less than or equal to mod a plus mod b.
No, I said use chat. Yeah, please remember. Right. So I have to use. So this will be less than or equal to mod x plus mod a times. You understand this? Now everything is fine. I wanted to check continuity at a. Therefore, I got an a here. But then this x is bothering. Mod x minus a, I have no problem. So I want to replace this by a constant. Okay. So what will I do? Use this. Mod x minus a is less than 1, therefore I want an estimate for mod x now. Now use add and subtract trick. Mod x minus a, this is less than or equal to, think of this as one number, this is another number, therefore that will be less than or equal to mod x minus a plus mod a. But I chose x such that mod x minus a is less than 1, therefore this is less than or equal to 1 plus mod a. You understand this? Therefore, this fellow is less than or equal to mod x minus a into 1 plus mod a plus mod a, that is 1 plus 2 times mod a. You understand this? So mod fx minus fa, I got an estimate. The only compromise I have made is I did not allow for any x. I allowed only for those x that mod x minus a is less than 1. Okay, I restricted my x to be only in this interval. We follow that. So now I want this to be less than epsilon. How will I make sure it's less than epsilon? That's very easy, right? That is mod x minus a should be less than epsilon by 1 plus 2 times mod a. Therefore, I can choose, you may say I have to choose delta, positive delta, so that is less than epsilon by 2 mod a. But remember, this is true only when this inequality is true. This inequality is true only if mod x minus a is less than 1. Therefore, mod x minus a must be less than 1, and mod x minus a should also be less than epsilon by 1 plus 2 mod a. Therefore, it should be minimum of how many of you understand this? Now think of your classroom or that typical textbook. The textbook will choose, give me an epsilon, choose delta equal to minimum of 1, comma epsilon by 1 plus 2 mod a, then you verify. You understand this? So student naturally get really threatened. He is intimidated. How can I know that this one minimum of 1 epsilon by 1 plus 2 mod a works? Of course it works. But how did you know? You don't explain. See, math is science. There is an explanation. You should explain. You don't do that. So naturally students dislike epsilon delta, because it's a mystery. Do you understand this? Okay, now let's look at slightly more involved example. Yeah, thank you. Enough. Let's look at something slightly more involved example. The same thing, just to make sure you understand it better. Now fix a natural number and say n equal to 1 is an identity, n equal to 2 I did, therefore I can as well assume n is greater than or equal to 3. But this is, I am not going to use this. Just I need only n is a natural number for my proof. So fix a in R. Now I will go a little faster. Please pay attention. Stay focused. Take 3 deep breaths. It will supply more oxygen to your brain, so that it will be able to think. I won't be apologetic like Satya. He is young. I am not. Okay. Right? So I want to show if it's continuous at A. Therefore, what do I know I have to estimate? Now I'm going to go fast. Okay. Be ready to run with me. You understand this? Please say yes if you understand. Quick.
Chilla.
Now, like last time, I am not going to this for up to this. This estimate is correct, right? Okay. Now I want to replace by a constant. So, like last time, I am going to allow x said that mod x minus a is less than 1. In that case, I have this is less than 1 plus mod a to the power n minus 1. Okay, and this will be 1 plus mod a to the power n minus 2 into mod a. You see that I can keep that, but it will not look nice. So what do I do? This is less than or equal to 1 plus mod a to the power n minus 2, and this fellow is less than or equal to 1 plus mod a. You understand this? Therefore, this product is also less than or equal to 1 plus mod a to the power n minus 1. Do you understand this? I could have got a cheaper estimate possibly. Okay. But I replace mod a is less than 1 plus mod a. Therefore, it became this. You understand this? Therefore, each of the term is less than 1 plus mod a to the power n minus 1. Therefore, how many such terms are there? I start with n minus 1, keep on doing, I get to 0 to power of x I get. Therefore, n terms. Therefore, this is less than or equal to mod x minus a times n into 1 plus mod a to the power n minus 1. Now, I want this to be less than epsilon. Therefore, it's enough if I make this less than epsilon. That means I have to make sure mod x minus a should be less than epsilon by. Now you see this horrendous looking object. Yeah. And for this inequality to be true, I wanted mod x minus a to be less than 1. Therefore, my delta should be as earlier. Now you put yourself in student's shoe at the age of 19, okay? I want to prove continuity of f of x equal to x power n. Let epsilon be given. Choose delta equal to this and start writing the proof. Would you have liked it? Be honest. You understand? So this is a kind of mystery. That is why students have problem with epsilon delta definition. First, they do not understand why epsilon comes first, delta comes next. I explained in terms of practical real life examples. Second, given epsilon, don't write delta. Discover the delta, derive the delta, find out the delta on your own, and then you verify. Okay, let us look at a third example. This is somewhat easier than the earlier. Of course, this goes to positive reals, but I don't do that. How many of you can guess what function I want to write? How many of you can guess what should be the function I want to write? I expected somebody to say, that's not what I wanted.
Log x, sir, log x, sir, log x, sir, log.
I'm coming to that. See, I know, that's why it was a temptation. I would have written as non-zero real, then you would have guessed it correctly. I wrote it positive because I wanted to tell you a lesson. See, this kind of continuity, you cannot directly prove for all our calculus functions, what they are called transcendental functions. Exponential function, log function, the trigonometric functions, hypergeometric function, because none of them is rigorously defined. We learned how to work with it. You understand? It's like learning, I know how to drive a car, but I don't know how to build a car. Okay? So I know how to work with these functions. What are their properties? I learned by heart. So I know how to work with that. We are never rigorously defined. That is the drawback. Okay, this is the best time you should also learn, because there are people who are too algebraically oriented. They are very formal. Everything should be very rigorously proved. Then you will see that there is a problem with analysis. Because, again, go back, like I accept God exists, you also accept real number system exists. Have you constructed ever? I know your natural numbers. I know integers, I know rational numbers. All of a sudden you said there is a real number system which contains rational numbers in which I mean square root exists. and there is LEB property, RR completeness, Cauchy completeness, or whatever you want. You never exhibit it. And similarly, log these functions you never explain very, very rigorously. Okay, you want to define them rigorously, it takes one semester course of analysis. You see that? Therefore, if you want me to prove cos x is continuous, log x is continuous, e power x is continuous, or cosine hyperbolic is continuous, okay, it cannot be done now. Do you understand this? So what we do is with this kind of trick only, but that's good enough. And second thing is, you should understand all the first course in real analysis theorem, okay, all deal with functions, continuous function, differential function, integral functions, everything. You will be surprised, till 19th century, there was no formal understanding of what is real number system. Okay, only when Dirichlet came and Cantor came, all of us understood what a very rigorous way of constructing real number system. Next, and all these analysis theorems dealt with functions. But do you know when now 8th standard student or even 7th standard student knows what is the definition of a function? A function from a set x to y is a rule which to each x in the domain associates a unique y in the codomain, and that y we call it fx. You know when this definition was formulated? 1937. Okay. So many of the things we have to work with it. But remember, all these big theorems were proved by top class mathematicians. Okay. So please understand, do not go overboard. Like if you are algebraic, think only algebra. Don't try to produce algebraic thinking in analysis. So the function I want to do is 1 by x. Right? Now I want to fix a positive number. This is my 0. This is my a. A may be very close to 0, but I'm using a magnifying glass and showing as though a is very far away from 0. It may be here. Okay, I want to prove continuity at A. So again, what do you think? You will tell, give me epsilon. I will say, no, I don't worry about epsilon now. What will I worry about? How to estimate fx minus f. What is fx? 1 by x. What is f? 1 by a. What is this? Then all of us had been brought up, tried to kind of take a common denominator and try to arrive at some nice expression. So what will I do? Don't say a minus x, okay? With modulus, there is no difference. Do you understand this? Where x should be? X should be in the domain, therefore x is always positive. Therefore, I don't even have to write x with modulus, a as modulus. What all I have to write is mod x minus a by x times a. Do you understand this? So what do I want? I want this to be less than epsilon. Notice that I have mod x minus a, therefore I am happy. And a is a fixed number, therefore I am also happy. But x is allowed to vary anywhere on the positive reals. So like last time, again, I will not allow x to vary too much. I will allow x to vary only in a small interval around a. Why I want it? You should understand this x times a, not a minus. Right? If I can show, let us look at this. If I can show, this is something like c times mod x minus a by a, I want this to be less than epsilon, then I am through. Because mod x minus a should be a epsilon by c. You understand? That means I have to make sure 1 by x is less than c. That means x must be greater than 1 by c. That means I should allow x may be positive, but I don't want it to be any positive real number. It should stay away from a positive real number. You should stay away from 0 by a positive real number. Do you understand this? Let me again repeat. I am working backwards. If okay, if I can replace 1 by x by c, it is less than c, then I am happy. Because then I have to choose mod x minus a should be a epsilon by c. Then I am through. Okay, I have to choose a delta which is less than this. Okay, what does it mean to say 1 by x is less than c? It is same as saying x is greater than 1 by c. Now remember, 1 by x is already positive, it's less than c, therefore c is positive. That means x must be greater than some fixed positive number. Which positive number? It could be anything. It could be anything. So for definiteness sake, let me assume a by 2 and 3a by 2. You understand? If I choose L delta equal to a by 2, then a minus delta by 2, a plus delta by 2 is what I am looking at. Right? So if x lies only in this interval, then x is strictly greater than a by 2. Do you understand that? So I will restrict myself. That is, x lies in the interval a by 2 to 3a by 2. Okay, this I want to. This means x is greater than a by 2, therefore 1 by x is less than 2 by a. Remember, they are all positive numbers. Therefore, I can, with impunity, I can take the reciprocals and get the inequality. You understand that? Therefore, if x lies in this interval, 1 by x will be less than 2 by a. Therefore, mod fx minus fa is less than mod x minus a by a, and 1 by x is less than 2 by a. You understood this? Now I wanted this to be less than epsilon. Therefore, it's enough if I make this to be less than epsilon. Okay, that means what? 2 into mod x minus a by a square should be less than epsilon. That means my delta should be less than a squared epsilon by 2. I hope I am writing correctly. Yeah. But remember, for this inequality to be true, okay, I wanted x to be greater than a by 2, that is mod x minus a should be less than a by 2. Therefore, I have to choose a delta which is minimum of a by 2 and a squared epsilon by 2. Now you see that this is such a simple example to prove continuity. If you give me an epsilon, I start with choose any positive delta which is minimum of a by 2, a squared epsilon by 2. Okay, naturally, even my students will hate mathematics. But if you tell them how we arrive at it, then they will love. Because then it's a kind of nice thing for them to find out on their own. Let me quickly look at the same example with a slightly modified. Okay. Now my domain is fixed, let's say alpha to infinity, where alpha is a positive number. F of x equal to 1 by x. Now let us go fast. Fx minus fa will be, as I said, mod x minus a by x into a. But remember, my x is here. That means x is greater than or equal to alpha, therefore 1 by x is less than equal to 1 by alpha. Therefore, this is less than equal to 1 by alpha into a into mod x minus a. So I want this to be less than epsilon. That means I have to make this less than epsilon. That means I have to choose delta to be less than epsilon into alpha minus a, alpha times a. And it should also be less than 1, therefore it should be minimum of 1 by a. I may have gone fast here, but it was very intentional. You should learn to go back and review. Let us look at one more example. and I will stop there and you will look at. We always looked at continuous functions. Let us look at one function. Maybe I will do two functions quickly. Suppose I look at a function f from R to R, so that fx, let us say, is minus 1, if x is less than 0, equal to 1, if x is greater than equal to 0. So, the function is this. Right? So, all of you know, obviously from your earlier experience, you know the function is not continuous at 0. Now, how do I prove it? Okay, how do I prove it? If it is continuous at 0, what do I know? I have to estimate mod fx minus f0. Right? I want this to be less than some epsilon. Right? Then I have to find some delta interval around this. Right? What do I know? You take any delta interval around this, then I can always find your negative number here, some x here, so that x will be negative. Therefore, fx will be minus 1, whereas f of 0 is plus 1. Therefore, this means minus 1, minus 1, which is minus 2, modulus, that is 2. I want 2 to be less than epsilon. Therefore, how will I argue now? Start with epsilon to be any number, even equal to 2 is allowed, but anyway, take. Okay? If f is continuous at 0, then there is a delta, so that whenever mod x minus a, that is 0, is less than delta, mod fx minus f0 should be less than epsilon. If f are continuous, my epsilon is less than delta. Now what do I do? Choose any delta. Then I said I can always choose a negative x. But pictorially negative x is okay, but you should give me explicitly a point. That is easy. Take x equal to minus delta by 2. Do not say there exists x. Intuitively it's clear, but don't say that. There is a delta. Namely, they take x equal to minus delta by 2. That is in this interval. But it is negative. Therefore, what is the f of x? It is minus 1. Therefore, this is equal to minus 1 minus 1 is less than. That is 2 is less than epsilon. That's a contradiction. So f is not continuous. And let us look at the sixth example. This is what one usually calls a step function. Instead of step function, let me do a greatest integer function. Because everybody knows step function, but let's do that. You know what is the greatest integer function? F of x equal to, I think, the floor function. Am I right, Satya? Is it called floor function or roof function?
Floor function, sir. Floor.
What I have done is correct, right?
Yeah, correct, sir. Correct. Floor function, correct.
What does this mean? This is the unique integer m, which is less than or equal to x, which is strictly less than m plus 1. You call m as the greatest integer less than or equal to x. So how does the picture look? All of you know. So here it will be 0, here it will be 1, here it will be 2, and so on. And similarly minus. Right? Now suppose I want to prove, you give me a point A which is strictly between m and m plus 1. It is not an integer. Then it is very easy. What do I do? I have a and it is between m and m plus 1, or it may be like this. You understand? Now choose a delta which is minimum of this distance, then that it will be completely contained in here. For this delta, you can see the function is always going to be m, because the greatest integer less than or equal to a is m. And for every x here also, it is less than or equal to m is less than equal to this point, any x here, and similarly for any x. Therefore, it will be continuous. Okay, it's actually m. Therefore, for any epsilon, it will be clear. Are you following me? Am I going fast? Okay. Now suppose by a you put an integer m, then how will I argue? So this is my m. Now you choose any delta interval m minus delta to m plus delta, where delta is positive, then I am in trouble, because if I take x here, or if you take a y here, you see there is going to be trouble. What will be f x? The greatest integer less than or equal to x will be m minus 1. Do you understand this? Because it's strictly less than m. Okay, the x which I drawn is strictly less than m. Therefore, this will be m minus 1. Whereas for y, it will be, it is greater than m, therefore it will be m. Right? Now do you see a problem? Suppose I take epsilon equal to 1, if you say there is a delta positive, such that f is continuous at m, you understand? I am claiming it's not continuous at an integral point. Suppose it's continuous. Now let me take epsilon equal to 1, then there is a delta positive, so that for m minus delta to m plus delta, for every x in m minus delta to m plus delta, what should I have? Mod fx minus f of m should be less than epsilon, which is should be less than 1. But if I take my x, the red x here, then its value is m minus 1, its f at m, the value is m, therefore this will be mod 1. Therefore you are getting a contradiction known as less than 1. That's a contradiction. Again, you see that which epsilon I choose to prove not continuous, I started estimating and I found out which epsilon I needed. Okay. So I have given few examples, and the best place for you to look at lot more examples is this book. It teaches you how to choose these things very precisely. And also be on the watch out for my videos on YouTube. In the next one series will be dealing with epsilon delta. I'll do a lot more examples there. But I hope it convinces you, if epsilon delta definition is not appreciated or understood by students, it's our mistake. We do not explain how the epsilon delta definition came. It is a real life necessity. It's nothing to do with mathematicians' abstract thinking, okay, to make our life difficult. No. It was demanded by experimental sciences, engineering sciences. And second thing is, as a mathematician, next our problem comes that we only do verification method. You let epsilon be given, choose delta equal to this, then I keep on verifying. Then the student as well as you are intrigued, how did the author knew which delta he has to choose? How did he know that? I explained with some 4 or 5 examples, and there are a lot more. Please go through. And I'm sure if you explain these 2 exam, real life examples, students will begin to appreciate. And again, if you don't want, okay, you can go back to the easy definition of continuity, which I have given in the video. It is also given in my book. Okay, it's unfortunately we don't keep change, adapt ourselves to changing situations. Just because we learned continuity using right limit, left limit, etc., etc., then we still live the same way. This is unfortunate. That's 19th century mathematics. We have to adapt ourselves. We have to change. Then came epsilon delta, but epsilon delta is also good. We are going to show do that later sometime, not here. Okay. But there is still an easier method. See, mathematics deals with how does it solve problems? Mathematics is for solving problems. There are two standard tricks of solving mathematics. Let me stop sharing. There are two standard methods of doing mathematics, solving problems. One is, if you give me a problem, I try to reduce the problem to a problem which I had already solved. The second trick is, try to see some problem which is analogous. It may not be exactly the same. Try to see whether tools which I used can be adapted to solve this new problem. Right? My easy method deals with this. See, students are already learned sequences. If xn converges to x, yn converges to y, xn plus yn converges to x plus y. Xn times yn converges to x times y. A constant c times xn converges to c times x. And if xn's are non-zero and x is non-zero, if xn converges to x, 1 by xn converges to 1 by x. Okay, these are already solved in sequence chapter. Then use it to prove continuity problems. Very, very easy. You can see in my video, within 58 minutes, I have done 12 examples and I have proved all the so-called algebra of continuous function. If f and g are continuous, f times g is continuous, f plus g is continuous, c times f is continuous. If f is does not take zero value, 1 by f is continuous and mod f is continuous, maximum of f and g is continuous. All these things are done within 1 hour. Starting with the definition of continuity. So it can be done. There is an easier approach to continuity. We should follow. Just because some textbook is given, unfortunately, all of us have to do left limit, right limit, epsilon, delta, and you know, drive away students from mathematics. Okay? Please, we should change. We are in 21st century. Thank you very much. I am ready for questions and answers. Yes.
Sir, may I have a question?
Yes, ask.
Please. Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
I want to pose a question regarding defining real number system.
How to define real number system?
You can define like an ordered field which satisfies LUB property. That's the approach I take. An ordered field which contains a set of rationals, the field of rational numbers. Okay. R is an ordered field containing Q. Actually, that's not needed, but I always assume which satisfies the LUB property.
Sir, that is the
That's the definition. But your question is there. You have something else in mind, but the way you said is how to define. My answer is 110% correct, precisely.
Yes, sir. Yeah, that's better. That was given in the textbook, but is there any other way?
No, you see, the point is you have to construct. The idea is if you given a set of rational numbers, okay, I can construct a real number system and show that it has the LUB property. And how do I construct a real number system out of rational numbers? There are two different approaches. One is the so-called Dedekind cut method. I earlier said Dedekind, I meant Dedekind at the time. Dedekind cuts. The other one is Cantor's sequential method. And you can, if you go to MTTS site, you will see an article of mine, construction of real numbers, which takes the Cantor's method, which is somewhat easier. Okay, you can check it. So one can construct real number system. So we know, okay, the God exists here for real analysis. Okay, assuming.
Thank you, sir.
Natural numbers exist. If natural Thank numbers you. Exist, integers exist, digits exist, rational numbers exist. If rational numbers exist, I can construct real numbers with the LUB property. Yeah. Next.
Hello. Namaste, sir.
Speak.
Kakinada, sir.
Yeah, I know you very well, Padmaja. Yesterday also you quoted a Sanskrit sloka.
Yes, in 2007, yes? You have explained about Archimedic property, and then I have to listen, I think, from your side, that is taking a small chalk piece and then distance. Hyderabad to Delhi. Using that example, you have given the idea about the statement of Archimedes.
See, right. So let us start with something. All of you should have studied, all of you should be young. So in your 12th standard, you should have studied physics, 11th and 12th, right? How many of you remember what is the first chapter in physics? Can somebody unmute mic and say? What is the first chapter in physics? Padmaja, don't say. You may already know the answer.
Units.
Yes. Units and? It's not units. Units and?
Measurements.
Measurements.
Units and dimensions.
I would like to share my screen to explain this. First, I will draw a number line and explain that, and after that, I will explain what really I will thrill the Satya about it 10 years ago. Okay, suppose this is a number line, right? I have 0 here, I have x very close to this, and this is my y. Okay, see this y, just because of the screen consideration is here, but you can imagine it's still longer, keep on going on the right side, keep on going here to the end of the screen, and further beyond y is there. Now do you see that I will mark x and twice x, thrice x, 4x. After certain times my n x would have been overshot, it would overshoot. Why? How many of you accept it? Yeah, you see that? So this is what Archimedean property says. It says, give me any positive real number and give me any real number. If y is negative, there is nothing. Then there exists a natural number n, so that nx is strictly greater than y. Okay, what does this show? I will explain. I will come back to units and measurement. Is this physically understandable, intuitively appealing to you? Yes? Okay. Now, let us try to say what it says. It says that, okay, if depending upon your need, you choose anything as a unit. I am choosing x as a unit. Okay. Then, any quantity can be measured in terms of x. That is, my y will be lie between n minus 1 times x and n times x. So I had measured it. If you want, I will again go by fraction, and then that's why I do that. In other words, again try to understand. Okay, this is what my example is. Suppose I have a huge tank and full of water. Water is blue color, right? Okay. A very huge tank, something like 10 to the power 27 liters of water. Okay, now you have given me a small spoon, right? And there is no rain, there is no influx of water, inflow of water. And if you give me something like 200 to the power 90,000 years of life, right? And enough energy, then I can slowly, one by one, I can take it out and empty this tank. Do you understand this? This may be small, it may be something like 5 ml or 10 ml, but if you give me long enough life and energy, I can keep on taking water out of this and it will dry. You accept it? Now, where does this basis of unit come? Suppose I have one star in this galaxy, another star in another galaxy, Now it will be stupid of me to say the distance between them in terms of centimeter, meter, or kilometers. What is the unit I use? Light years. Yeah, but if you take two cities in India, then I will try to measure the distance in terms of kilometers. If you take two spots in my house, I will try to measure it in terms of feet, not even meter perhaps. Right? Now you put two spots on my floor, then I may use centimeters to measure the distance. Right? Now you have an atom or a molecule, in that I want to find the distance between the neutron of this atom and this neutron, distance between neutron of this atom and neutron of this atom, then I will do something like 10 to the power minus 7 kind of unit, sir. Nano kind of thing. So what it says is, depending upon your need, physical need, you can choose any positive quantity as a basic unit. And anything of the same kind can be measured using X. That is why units and then measurement. Okay, think about it. You should expand, you should discuss with your friends. Yeah. I'm through. If you want some more questions, you should ask me. Shall I stop sharing now?
Yep.
Yeah.
Sir, we need to explain uniform continuity, sir.
Huh?
Uniform continuity.
Uniform continuity.
Yeah, who is asking?
Naidu, sir.
Naidu. Sir, see, again, I'm sorry. Yesterday, somebody asked about uniform continuity, and Professor Kannan said, in fact, that his explanation is the source of all evil for uniform continuity. In fact, all over the world, people keep saying the same thing. To prove continuity at A, I choose a delta, which depends upon epsilon and the point A. And if I choose a delta independent of A, then it is uniformly continuous. That is a very, very bad way of understanding uniform continuity. All textbooks, all teachers, 99.99% of the teachers across the world will define it like that. In fact, only students of MTTS and my faculty in MTTS, I tell them, you should never say that. That's a very wrong thing. I will give an example. Okay? I'll first give a story. Usually I am fond of stories. The story is, there was a person who was sick, who had a terminal cancer, incurable disease. He went to a very well-known doctor. He was world famous. He was supposed to cure every disease. This patient went to him. The doctor saw he cannot cure him. But his ego did not want to say, I can't cure you. So what he did was, he gave him a medicine. He said, you take this medicine religiously 3 times a day. After about 1 month, you will be cured. You will feel better. Okay. The only condition is, when you take the medicine, you should not think of a monkey. Put yourself in his position. You are going to take the medicine. What will you do? Okay. So after 1 month, the patient was still alive. He came back to the doctor and said, doctor, I did everything, but it is becoming worse. Then the doctor asked, I gave you a condition. Do you remember? He said, yes. What was the condition? I am not supposed to think of a monkey. What happened? Every time I took the medicine, I thought of a monkey. What has this to do with uniform continuity? Precisely this. When I want to show a function is uniformly continuous, you are hung, you are obsessed, you want to choose a delta independent of A, so you are concentrating on A and delta. You are concentrating on the monkey. So you are not going to get cured. and it also defeats the real purpose of uniform quantity. I will again share, and I think that should be the last. I think it's almost more than 1.5 hours. All of you may also be tired, but let me do that. The correct way to define uniform continuity is this. Is it okay if I explain in terms of metric space? If you want, you can think of as real line also. So x is a subset of real line and it takes values y, y is a subset of real line. Or if you know, you can also think of metric spaces. It's up to your choice. Okay. Now what it is to say is that if you give an epsilon positive, then in x, if it's r, it will be something like this. Take any two points x1 and x2. Notice that I am not fixing a point a now. I am starting with any x1, x2. The moment this distance is less than delta, then this is my y, this is my fx, this is my fy. This distance should be less than epsilon. So you can take any two points here. I don't care where they are. They may be anywhere. Two arbitrary points. The only condition is that distance between them should be less than delta. Then their images should be at a distance less than epsilon. That is the correct way of defining uniform continuity. What is the advantage? If I have to check a function f is uniformly continuous, it tells me I should estimate fx1 minus fx2 in modulus. I should not estimate fx minus fa and then choose delta independent of a. Do you understand? The correct way I should look at is, start with two arbitrary points x1, x2 in the domain. Look at mod fx1 minus fx2 or distance between fx1 and fx2 in case of metric spaces. Try to estimate this. But if you think of a monkey, what will you say? I should estimate mod fx minus fa and choose a delta independent of a. Now you are concentrating on the monkey. You will not get it. If you want, I get an example. I did an example here. You see that? See, I was still thinking of a. My a was there. You see that? But a is also an element of this, therefore I just kept it alive. Okay, I kept this because I knew somebody will ask me on uniform continuity. See, I have seen thousands of people. So I know what questions students and participants and teachers will ask me. So I very, very deliberately left this example. A, but A also is here. So I could have replaced A by alpha squared. A is greater than or equal to alpha, therefore 1 by a also less than equal to alpha. If I had done this, look at this, the same example. Now x1 is greater than or equal to alpha, x2 is greater than or equal to alpha, therefore I will have only this. You see that there is no a. You will not hang up with the delta. Then you have to choose delta independent of A. That is why I said, do not think of a monkey. Do not say your delta should be independent. But if you look at the definition, as a corollary, okay, you give me any A in X, then I can choose the same delta. If the distance or mod X minus A is less than delta, then this is like my x1 and x2. Therefore, mod fx minus fa will be mod fx1 minus fx2. That will be less than epsilon. Therefore, as a corollary, I deduce I can choose delta independent of a. Okay? Please do not think of a monkey. That's it. Yeah, I am through. Are there any more questions? Maybe all of you should be tired because Satya also made it highly interactive. So he kept prodding you to think. And I don't know how much I did succeeded, but I was also trying to prod you to think. So maybe most of you are tired. I forgot to thank all of you. See, I'm always worried about teaching, okay? Thank you very, very much. It has been really wonderful.
Thank you, sir. Well said.
Thank you very much.